Okay, church, how many of you have a person in your life? I mean, if they're in here, don't point them out. This would be really awkward. But who makes watching movies or TV together just a little bit, well, annoying? Can you identify? You know what I'm saying? That was a great snort. Okay. We all have, I mean, there's got to be someone, a sister, an uncle, a spouse, be honest. So I read online the 5 top ways you can ruin a movie. Don't write these down like homework, okay? Don't be like, oh, awesome, I need to learn that. No, listen, I'm saying this because these bother me, okay? And one of them I'm guilty of, and I'll let you guess which one. Tell me if you've seen this. The number one way to ruin a movie or a TV show is to open your mouth. And I don't just mean like, although that would be really annoying to sit with someone in the theater, eh? It's good, eh? Okay, that would be annoying, but that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the movie begins, and if you've seen the movie before, you know, a good way to spoil it for everyone is talking about the ending at the start. Do you have anyone that's ever done that? They start going, oh, you know what I'm talking about? They just won't be quiet. They keep giving you pointers as to what is coming up next. Is that annoying? Okay, here's the second one. Keep a running commentary. This one I'm guilty of, actually. Right? Oh, this is going to be good. Oh, you watch. Oh, no way, not her. I do that. Does anyone here do that? Come on, let's have some honesty here. I'm always doing that. I'm like, I bet you it's that guy or whatever. He gives a pointer. When the main character dies, if this is you, try saying in a calm voice, game over. That's some of you in here. Anyway, you won't win any friends if you do this. Number 3, talking about things that have nothing to do with the movie. Like, come on. You're in the middle of a thick plot moment and they go, hey babe, did you take the garbage out? Who cares? Ask after, write it on a note. I don't know, okay. Might be someone in here. Number 4. People who start singing to music that's in the movie. Have you done this? I mean, if it's Aladdin, fine. We all want to sing, I can show you the world. I mean, thank you. You've done it, haven't you? Yes, you have. Or Frozen, come on, you watched that with your kids, you were annoyed the first 3 times, and then after that, you're going, let it go, let it go. You've done it. Come on, people. That's why they're doing Frozen 2. You knew this, right? It's because of people like you. Okay, here's the 5th one. Be the person who has no idea what's going on. This is what made me look for the top 5 list. Because there's someone in my life, you don't know them, but it's like we start the movie at the same time. Is anybody with me on this? You start at the same time and 3 minutes in, they're like, who's that guy? We're watching the same movie. I have as much knowledge so far as you do. Okay, right? 5 minutes in, why did she do that? I don't know. You can't interact. It's not one of those movies. Okay, all right. Clearly rabbit trailed off the script here. Wow, it's a leap to get back to the central theme of where I was going, but because that was a personal beef for me. Okay, everybody ready to make the leap back into the Word of God? Come on, people. Here we go. We all watch differently, don't we? Woo! That's the central theme, believe it or not TV and movies, but when it comes to prophecy, when it comes to the return of Jesus, Paul now switches gears and says, okay, look, I taught you chapter 1, what it is to be born spiritually. And he sort of likens this parallel to like a baby. You're born. Then chapter 2, you're nurtured. Chapter 3, you stand strong like a little child when they first stand. Chapter 4, you begin to walk. And now, chapter 5, he says what's key to your faith, and he's speaking to this young church in Thessalonica, is you learn how to watch properly. You learn how to watch differently. And he's going to really break it into 2 camps. He's going to go, there are those who are Christians, and the assumption he makes, he doesn't even deal with Christians in a sense who aren't watching. He calls us all to say, as Christians, there needs to be this this total like prophetic watching of what is going on towards the return of Christ. Not political watching, not predictive watching, but prophetic watching. Amen? There's a difference. Right? We don't take everything from the newspaper and go, oh, there it is. That means we don't know that. We don't start calling out days, or this is the day. It doesn't work so well when people start predicting the day that Jesus will return. But we are prophetically to watch. And that's what he says. You begin to grow up as a young church. You begin to grow up as a young Christian. And you move from where now you need the support of the spiritual coffee table to where you're walking with the Lord. And then what? You need to get your eyes up on the return of the King. It is something that purifies, the Bible says. It is something that puts you back on course. And it is something definitely, perhaps one of the greatest, that makes it so that you are much more missional. The idea that Jesus can return at any time to take his church. And what he's pointing out here is the difference between those who are watching. That there is a massive difference between those who know the Lord and are watching and those who don't and aren't. Check it out, verse 1. But concerning the times and seasons, brethren, you have no need that I should write to you. Now this is an interesting term if you're a note taker, a student of the Bible. You may want to jot this down. The term times and seasons is only found three times in the scripture. And it's used in context always for God's plan for Israel. J. Vernon McGee, the great preacher, says, Israel is God's timepiece or watch. And I believe that's true. You can find it, the first reference is Daniel 2:21. If you got a Bible, you look it up later on. He's talking about Israel. Also in Acts 17:26. And then in Acts 1:6, and it's a common passage that we know. Remember where the disciples, after the resurrection of Jesus, they sort of pin him on this one question. Hey, Jesus, will you now restore the kingdom of Israel? And what are they asking? Well, remember that the Bible that the disciples had was only the Old Testament. And so they're very familiar with the writings of the Old Testament. And what we see is that they're so familiar that they're asking about this time when Israel will be restored because it's throughout the Old Testament. And they're asking, when's it going to be? And when are these promises going to come about? And Jesus says in his response, very interestingly, in Acts chapter 1, he says, it's not for you to know, here it is, the times or the seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. In other words, only the Father knows the specifics of that information. It's classified, if you will, even to the Son as he was on the earth. And that's why I think Paul here is like, listen, you have no need that I write to you. That's what he's saying to this young church. Why? Because Jesus told you, and you won't know the specific, but you are to be watching prophetically. That's what he's been saying in the whole of 1 Thessalonians. And of course, we see that throughout scripture in Matthew 25, verse 13. Jesus said, so you too must keep watch, for you do not know the day or the hour. So as you can see, when is out, but watch is in and healthy. We need to be those believers who are watchful. And then what Paul's going to do is both unpack for us what it is to be a watching Christian. He'll use words like sober. He'll use words like ready and not sleeping. And we're going to go through those, but he'll also contrast it with what it's like for the non-Christian. And maybe that's you here today. And as I said in the prayer, just so you know, it's our heart at Mountain Springs. We're so thankful that you're here. Keep seeking. Keep checking out the things of the Lord. That is the best thing you can do. I can tell you that firsthand. I know years back, I continued to pursue and I found the Lord. Or I could say better, the Lord found me. And that's a promise. You can read about that in Jeremiah 29, 11 to 13. You know, nothing's really changed since Jesus told the disciples that it's not for you to know. And as people who love Jesus, whenever we hear something or someone coming out with dates like the guy from Florida, we just kind of like tune out. Why? We don't go there. It's not for us to do that. But again, we're still watching, we're still looking and keeping alert. Okay, Joel, so what do we watch for? Check it out, verse 2. For you yourselves know perfectly, it's going to give us some indicators here, that the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night. Any of you here old enough to remember, I think it was 1970s, the movie Thief in the Night? Remember that one? Yeah, I think I watched it when I was in the first ever youth group I went to, they played it. I'm sure someone invited me thinking, I gotta reach that guy. And it was like this freaky, I think it was a 1970s or 80s, maybe early 80s movie. It was like everyone went missing and it was this bit, it freaked me right out. This is where they got it from, right here. This concept of the thief in the night. But before we get into that, what is the day of the Lord? In the Bible, the word day can refer to, and often, most often does, a 24-hour period. We see that in Genesis with the six-day account, literal 6 days, or two longer times. Can also be referred to as day also when God has a special purpose. I'll give you an example. Genesis 2 verse 3, the word means 24 hours, but in Genesis 2 4, it describes the entire time, season, or week of creation. And so the day of the Lord is that time specifically. As you go through your Bibles, you'll see it keep coming up. Usually they'll capitalize the letter D. And it's this time where God is going to judge the world and punish the nations, and at the same time, prepare Israel for the return of Jesus to establish his kingdom. So I'll give you a few examples here. If you've got a pen, you can jot these down. Joel chapter 2, verse 1. Zephaniah 1, 14 to 18. Read these on your own time. They're very descriptive. Isaiah 2, verses 12 to 21. The day of the Lord. Joel 2 verse 1 says, blow the trumpet in Zion and sound an alarm in my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble. For the day of the Lord is coming, for it is at hand, a day of darkness and gloominess, a day of clouds and thick darkness. And on as you look through the scripture. And often, prophecy scholars and students will call this the tribulation, and they'll sort of point to Revelation 6 to 19 as the most vivid description of what will take place in this period. So basically, the day of the Lord is what? It's an extended length of time that includes judgment of about 7 years. Now, we don't know the when, but we know a little bit about the how in these words. He says it comes as a thief in the night. So, you know, let's think about this. Before we guess what the return of Jesus will be like, let's ask what it won't be like, okay? When a thief comes, does a thief ring the doorbell? Okay, unless he's like a first timer or not good at it, right? We would all agree, no. Does he announce his arrival? Here I am. I'm here for your jewelry. Does he do that? No. Does he come simply to make an appearance? Like he shows up and does nothing? No, usually he's after something, to take something away almost violently. Does he dress in a way that's noticeable to all? Wouldn't that be just classic? The neon jacket and the flashing Christmas light hat? No. Does he come in slowly, kind of sit on the couch, catch a breath, chill out, talk to the kids? Kick it on the Xbox. No! You have to understand what a thief doesn't do to get the implication here. It is stealth-like. The thief comes stealthily. He's unannounced. He's quiet. There is a quickness to it. And there is the horror that follows, if you will. Look what he says. He explains this more in verse 3. For when they say, peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them as labor pains upon a pregnant woman, and they shall not escape. Now, Paul, as I've said at the start, is making great efforts and pains to make the distinction between those who are in the know and those who don't know. See, friends, if you know Jesus, here's the encouraging part. You are the jewel or the treasure that he will come for at an hour unknown to you. Jesus is going to come. He's going to lift you up stealthily. He's going to take you away. But for those who don't know, those who aren't watching, it will be the shock and the horror that remains. But you say, Joel, well, the passage says peace and safety. Explain that to me. That's true. And there's this prevailing thought, and we see it through Scripture. We see it in the book of Ezekiel. We also see it in the book of Zechariah, that right before Jesus comes for his church, like a thief in the night, there's going to be this sense, this growing sense of peace and safety. Zechariah 12:2 gives us a bit of an indicator to that. It says, "Behold, I will make Jerusalem a cup of drunkenness to all the surrounding peoples when they lay siege against Judah and Jerusalem." So in Zechariah, we're told here that all these surrounding peoples are literally intoxicated with Jerusalem. Let me ask you a question. Is the whole world intoxicated with Jerusalem today? I believe it is. I believe that the whole world is intoxicated with Jerusalem because of this two-state solution that wants to be brought about. Jews and Palestinians living side by side in peace and security. And this has gone on for decades. America has sent different teams and individuals over to strike a peace accord to try to get these two states to live side by side. In fact, over 20 times delegates have been sent to Israel to strike this accord between the Palestinians and the Jews. And here's the amazing part. During the Obama administration alone, of those 20, 9 of them happened just during Obama's administration through John Kerry and his efforts. This ongoing peace accord, this push to achieve it. If you come to Israel with us, it will blow your mind because some of the stuff, you see the evidence right when you're there. You see people building things and organizations coming together all to set this up. It's quite incredible on the Temple Mount. And there's this push to achieve this elusive two-state solution. And it's already on the table to make peace and security the forefront issue of the entire world. I believe that today. But it'll be a false peace, the Bible talks about. It'll be a brokered peace, a 7-year peace treaty, I believe. And the Scripture talks about that. We just don't have time today to go into it. But Jesus said the same thing. This shouldn't surprise us. When talking about this period, this 7-year period, what did he say in Luke 17? He says, "As it was in the days of Noah, so it shall be in these days." What was the days of Noah like? Everybody's just sort of doing their own thing, sort of partying their face off, and then what? After repeated warning, 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 all of a sudden destruction falls. But what does God do? God removes Noah from the judgment, lifts him up in a boat, and protects him and a remnant while the destruction is poured out on the earth. Jesus, in his own commentary on this, in case we don't get it, he goes on, he says, hey, what about Sodom and Gomorrah? Maybe you know the story. Lot and his family is in this region, and an angel comes and says, we got to pull you out. And they're pulled out right before destruction falls upon Sodom and Gomorrah. He rescues a remnant through it and from it. And God sort of drags Lot out of the city, and then the judgment falls. What's significant about these two examples that Jesus gives us is the quiet removal of God's people before the destruction comes. Like a thief who's at work, silently removing, stealthily, the treasure, the jewels, and then the judgment falls. So the day of the Lord begins stealthily, and God's people are removed or caught up, as we read in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. God takes the treasure out, then the judgment breaks out. Now, there's another description Jesus gives. He says in that passage, a terrible time of destruction will come, great tribulation that has not been since the beginning of the world, nor ever shall be. And there's this idea in this whole thinking that it is inescapable. that there's a suddenness to it, an inescapability about the day of the Lord. And he uses this term, he says, like labor pains on a pregnant woman. Now, this idea of being in labor is not new when it comes to prophetic study. Isaiah used the same picture in chapter 13 of Isaiah. He says, wail, for the day of the Lord is at hand. The day of the Lord, destruction of the Almighty. And then he goes on to say, pangs and sorrows as a woman. In childbirth, it's the same idea. Matthew 24, Jesus spoke about what would happen. He said nation would rise against nation. And he says these are the beginning of sorrows, or literally the word in the Greek is birth pangs. It's the same sentence exactly. Now, I'm not going to be foolish enough to explain birth pangs to you. That would be a bad idea. But I've watched it four times. And that's almost as painful for us guys, right guys? No, I'm kidding. I would never say that. Okay, I was just seeing if you're still with me there. Like, what? No. In fact, the first time I was a husband coach childbirth. Did you know that? A childbirth coach for our first child, just to let you know. Now, the second time, I played cards with a friend, and I'm still paying for that. But you know what I do remember is this. It comes suddenly, right? There's no like, oh, here we go. This gradual increase. No, there's like, you've seen it in the movies. She's cleaning the house or something, and then all of a sudden, oh, we gotta go. And then there's that waddle, right, to the door. And what's the husband do? He's running around like, ah, the car, the bag. You've seen it. Some of you have been in it recently, right? So it's sudden when it does happen. Now, that's not the time, guys. That is not the time when you see the pain to go, you know, maybe we shouldn't have had kids. This is just, it's a lot of work. No, you're in it to win it. You're going through it. You're committed at that point. There is no way out. So it is the same with the day of the Lord. It's an intense pain. And the world will not be able to escape the judgments of God. And the only possible way to handle them is to find a means of escape from the wrath that is to come. Where's that come from? Jesus! You're like, finally, good news! It's the doom and gloom sermon of the year, I know. Jesus! Who the Bible says is the only one. What did he do? He absorbed the wrath of God for our sins, for your sins. Do you see why it's incredibly good news, church? Because if you know the incredible bad news, then you see that Jesus paid for it, you can understand it's incredibly good news. It's unspeakably good news that we must speak about. For it is the hope for everyone. Listen to how C.S. Lewis, the great writer and author of Narnia, said this. He said, God is going to invade this earth by force. But what's the good of saying you're on his side then when you see the whole natural universe melting away like a dream and something else, something it never entered your head to conceive comes crashing in. Something so beautiful to us and so terrible to others. See the division? That none of us will have any choice left. This time it will be God without disguise. Something so overwhelming that it will strike either irresistible love or irresistible horror into every creature. It will be too late then to choose your side. There's no use saying you choose to lie down when it's become impossible to stand up. That will not be the time for choosing. It will be the time when we discover which side we have already chosen, whether we realize it or not. Now today, in this moment, is our chance to choose the right side. God is holding back to give us that chance. It will not last forever. We must take it or leave it. And I want to add the words, today. When Jesus said to Zacchaeus, today salvation has come to this house. It's the same message that he's saying to you. Today is the day of salvation. Today, salvation needs to come to this house and to your house. Whether you're sitting here live, watching, or listening, salvation has been offered to you, no doubt, if you live in our culture, time and time and time again. It is time to respond. The Bible says that God wishes none to perish. God is not wanting his wrath poured out on you, so he gives you the free opportunity to respond and receive what Jesus did in your place. It's incredible. It's amazing grace. You say, okay, Joel, why is God delaying his coming? The Bible says he's delaying in his long suffering and his grace. He's giving more people, you perhaps, opportunity to turn to him and receive the salvation that is offered in his son, Jesus. So I ask you today, how about you? Have you turned to him yet? Have you yielded to the love of Jesus poured out on the cross? Don't wait. Turn to Jesus today. If you're listening or you're watching, turn to Jesus in your heart. Confess him as Lord and be saved from the wrath that is to come. The question is, has Jesus paid the penalty for your sin? He took the penalty, but have you personalized it and received it to yourself? Has he absorbed the wrath of God on behalf of you that you deserve? Has he done that for you? You'll only know if you've trusted in him. Has he taken the penalty of your sin upon himself? He did it for all, but have you received it? You say, well, it doesn't really matter, Joel. The end's not coming anyway. I mean, I'm just enjoying my life. The whole cry of this passage in my heart for this teaching might be just for one person in here or one person listening. And it's this: wake up. How many times will the Lord come and knock on the door of your heart and say, today, I love you. That's why you're hearing this message. It's not coincidence. Don't shift and look around. It's you. The Lord is saying to you today, come. I love you. I've provided a way. And you'll have opportunity to do that at the end of the service. Now, Paul continues as he makes a massive distinction between those that know the Lord and those that don't. Look what it says, verse 4. But you, brethren, are not in darkness, so that this day should overtake you as a thief. You are all sons of light and sons of the day. We are not of the night nor of darkness. Because we're sons of the day and the light, here's what he's saying. We don't have to be overcome by the darkness. That's good news. Listen, friend, if there's areas in your life where darkness is creeping in, that's not who God made you to be. It's a part of your fallenness, but there's a sense where God calls you higher, and he calls you to accountability, and he calls you to confess those sins one to another, because it's not who you are. You're a son of the light. You're a daughter of the light. You're a king's kid. And if you're walking around in the drags and in the mess and in the mire of the streets, that is not your identity. He calls you higher. So I question today, is there dark areas in your life? Because dark is not your home. And the Lord would say, hey, get right. Talk to someone and pray about it. The church is all about. Verse 6, therefore let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. There it is. Now obviously he's not saying don't sleep in the sense of at night, right? Okay. Don't want anyone in here thinking, right, jack myself up on coffee every night and I'm good. I won't miss his arrival. No, no, no. The word sleep here is talking about being apathetic. Sleeping in your faith. What's the opposite of sleepy? Watchfulness. And we have this amazing picture in the Old Testament of the watchman, this person they would put on this tower. And a watchman does three things. They watch for the enemy, they warn, and they wait to see what is coming. That's what they do. They are alert. They are ready at all times. When the enemy's coming, they make note and they sound the alarm. This is the watchman. Are you awake today to the gospel in your own life? Are you awake to the mission that God is moving on all around you? Are you awake to sharing the love of Jesus with others, to being invitational, to the problems in your neighborhood, to the lives in your neighborhood, in your workplace, to the brokenness in your family? Are you awake to the opportunities to grow as a disciple, even in the body, the different ministries? the men and the women when they pray, and the men and the women when they meet, and the midweek ministry, and the opportunity of Gravity Church to bring people to hear the gospel of Jesus. Are you awake to that? Or being mentored, or in a pod group, or Ignite, or Rejuvenate, or all the ministries that go on to make up the mission here at the body. Are you awake to that? Or are you simply going through spiritual osmosis? It's time to wake up. Church, listen, the call here of Paul to us and the Holy Spirit to us is, don't go to sleep. Don't snooze or hit the snooze button. Don't get lulled off into some kind of dream and fantasy that the world is offering. Some dream house, some getaway spot, some dream vacation, some get-rich-quick scheme, or fame, or leisure. Don't fall asleep like that you were created. Understand that you're created for a mission and a purpose. Understand that you'll get the ultimate satisfaction on the other side. Don't look for it here. It's not. Don't settle down. Don't settle. Don't retire in that sense. Get inspired. You have purpose in Jesus. You have mission. Don't be lulled into this life, which so many are, of self-indulgence. Oh, it's me. It's all about me. It's not. It's about Him, His ways, His mission, His people, and His harvest. When you're snoozing, you'll find you convince yourself it's all about you, your dreams, your plans, and your future. When you're awake, you realize spiritually it has nothing to do with that. God's got that. He'll take care of it. Get on board and get on mission with the Lord. And it is such a, I don't know if it's like that for you, but for me, when I find myself snoozing, I just start thinking about myself, and then all of a sudden, God hits me with something, and I wake up, and I go, Lord, what was I thinking? It's about you. And when we're on board, and when we're on mission, all of a sudden, He looks after those areas. So the thing, the challenge for us is to quit snoozing. We're to find, friends, our excitement, our adventure in Jesus. And in working with Him and in His body, rather than being all self-indulgent. And I truly believe in these days that God is wanting us to discern the times and realize that it's not about us. And there needs to be this focus that it's not about us. That it doesn't revolve around me. It's about Him. Secondly, these words, He says, be sober. What's it mean to be sober? Some of you are like, not drunk. Good. Well done. But the literal translation is, and if that's you, stop it, okay? But the literal translation is not, like some people in their mind, they see sober and they think unfun. Do you know what I mean? It's like the Bible says, be sober. And you think, okay, drain the joy out of my face. And just go, okay, I'm going to be sober now. Sober. And you kind of interact with people and you're like, okay, sober, grumpy, tense, uptight, always pointing out what's wrong in others. Got it. And that's what you think. When you read these verses, you think a sober Christian is like the grumpy Christian, right? Or the rammy Christian. I'm a soldier of the cross. I'm sober. You can have the same joy I have. Nobody wants your joy. They don't. That's not what he means by sober, right? It's only because the world spells drunk, party, fun that you think sober means not fun. But that's not true. Okay? This whole idea that you're just going to walk around grumpy and be the sober Christian guy in a tweed suit with a snarl he's had for 30 years. Well, I used to be like that until I married Tanya, and that solved it. But listen, what's it mean to be sober? You got a pen, jot it down, because this is what Paul's saying. Hey, I'm not going to tell you when Jesus is coming, but you need to watch. And while you're watching, here's how you need to act. Be sober. Okay, what's sober then? It means to take life seriously. A calm, sane outlook on life. To realize the serious nature of what God has called you to and placed you in. Older Christians are great, aren't they? A lot of them exhibit this. You talk with them and they're like, oh, I've walked with the Lord. Listen, you can trust Him. He's so faithful. They're just kind of level. But there's a seriousness about their walk, some of them. It also means this in the original, to not escape. I love that. Be sober. Don't be the drunk guy that's always running around. Don't escape. Face life head on. Be sober. Don't waste your life amusing yourself. That's what it means. See, our culture is a culture that delights in numbing and escaping and tuning out, doesn't it? I mean, there's a million ways you can do it. You can get drunk, do drugs, you can have illicit sex, you can play hours of video games or TV after work. You can throw yourself into education. Wow, there you go. Education or agitation, whatever you'd pick. You can throw yourself into business. You can throw your iPod on and crank the music so loud that you numb your brains out. You can buy toys. You can run away with those toys or on those toys or with those toys. And why do we do this? Well, I don't like life. Joel, I just don't like what's been dealt to me. I just want to run away. I just want to escape. God says, if you know Jesus, if you know his word, if you have the Holy Spirit, you need to look life square on, stare it down and say, I'm going to live my life with Jesus and for Jesus. Jesus paid for my sins. He didn't die on the cross so I could waste time. He didn't suffer lashings so I could drown away my suffering with a bottle. He didn't have a crown pierce his skull so that I could crown myself and my desires as king of my life. He is the king, and it's time to stop sleeping and to start being sober and serious. Face the things. Somebody passed me a book this week. It's all about youth choosing to do the hard thing. Love it. Where's that book these days? But maybe we need one for adults too, I was thinking. Because a lot of times we're like, oh, this is a hard thing. Well, I'm just going to hit the escape, eject button. Just run to the mountains, man. That's what I need right now. No, you maybe need to face the hard thing. It develops this thing we're losing in our culture. It's called character. All right, I've had my Rami pastor moment. Let's move on. All right. When I as a pastor see in people's lives things come up and rear their head and they don't want to face it, it gets to me. And there's this heart I have for people just to stare it head on and know Jesus allowed it, so walk through it, deal with it. Your brothers and sisters are here for you. We will support you through it. Don't take off. Verse 7, for those who sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at night, but let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet, the hope of salvation. So wake up, be sober, face it head on. Don't escape, don't run, but also not just wake up, but dress up. What's the breastplate do? It guards your heart. That's what the breastplate was for. How do you do that? Well, you guard it with faith. He says the breastplate of faith. That is, I'm trusting him. I'm trusting in his power in this situation that I'm going to face head on. Well, Lord, you're able to help me through this situation. I'm going to put my faith in you. It means I'm not trusting in myself. It means I don't have my own agenda. I'm looking to God and I'm looking to his word in faith. What else? He says, put on love, verse 8. Love for God's people, love for one another. There's a lot of benefits, church, to love. One of the benefits is protection. You know, the world tells you, guard your heart. And the Bible does too, but it means something different. When the world says, guard your heart, it says, you know, you went out and your heart got trampled, so pull back. Because, you know, you got trampled on last time. So, just hold out and don't be honest or open again until you're really sure because you'll get hurt. Protect yourself. But, you know, biblically, Scripture gives us almost the opposite of that. One of the ways I guard my heart is that I allow the love of God to flow from me and out to you. And you to me. And when I love you, that means I'm putting away unforgiveness. And bitterness, and gossip, and hatred, and past beefs, and fights. And I'm putting it away, and I'm putting on love. And then lastly, he says, put on the helmet of the hope of your salvation. Obviously, what does the helmet protect? Your mind, your brain, your thinking. And what is the hope of salvation? Is it, I hope I'm saved in the end? No. It's the hope that I am saved, that the wrath of God is not upon me. Jesus absorbed it for me. And that I can watch with expectation for the coming of the King. Hope is a confident expectation of coming good. And that's what Paul says. How do you navigate prophetically these things? Walk with the hope that Jesus is coming. Do you think that's a great witness to the people around you at work? When everyone in the office is going through something rotten, and you don't just drop your head like everyone else, instead you're the chipper, woohoo, kind of person. What a testimony to Jesus. Jesus didn't say, be witnesses for me. He said, be witnesses of me. Which means what? When I'm a witness of how Jesus would respond to a terrible work situation, everyone in the workplace goes, there's something different about him. And it's not me, it's not you, it's Jesus in you. That's what he's saying, the hope that you have. Verse 9, for God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. Love it. Who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. Paul says, God's not appointed us to wrath. It's so clear. Why? It's because we're so cool, Joel. It's because we're so good, right? No. The wrath that should come down on us again was poured out on Jesus when he took your place on the cross, when he paid for your sins, past, present, and future, on the cross. And consequently, we're not ordained for the wrath of the Lamb, but for his marvelous, glorious work of salvation. That's why it's amazing grace. Because though we should stand in the seat of the sinner condemned in the court of God's law, we should take the full punishment into the courtroom, walks Jesus and says, your honor, I'm going to pay for them. My blood, my life, in exchange for theirs, in exchange for their sin. That's what Jesus did. What does that make you want to do? It makes you want to do verse 11. And this is where we'll close out. Therefore, comfort each other and edify one another, just as you also are doing. Do you see the fork in the road? If you're just watching your stocks, if you're just watching your career position, if you're just watching for some girl or guy to come along and solve everything, and you're doing that outside of Jesus, it'll be like a thief in the night. That if you've fixed your eyes on Jesus, the hope of your salvation, if you have had his payment on the cross and received what he did for you, the hope of your salvation, and you're saved from your sin and the punishment of your sin, you're going to be incredibly encouraged today. And the outflow of that is, therefore, comfort one another and edify, just as you also are doing. What does that mean? You will naturally want to comfort those around you. That means to come alongside and edify. And that word gives us the picture of a house or a building of a house. And just like you'll want to build up others in the body of Christ as you too have been built up. Paul saw in this incredible love for each other in the church in Thessalonica that there was this building up and this encouraging of each other. Let me ask you today, do you need encouragement today? Is there something that's got you down? Is there something that's dampened your spirit, your heart, your approach, your outlook? Then grasp, get a hold of the reality, lift your head up to the hope of your salvation, that Jesus past paid for all your sin, future is coming back to take you as a thief in the night, and together you will be with the Lord forever. In the meantime, look for ways to encourage those around you. Look for ways to do it, even today. You know, encouragement's such a big need that we have. And yet so often we don't give it. As you look around in the body of Christ, be the person that says, Lord, put something encouraging on my heart for someone today. I'm going to call the worship team up. We're going to close in song. As we do that, I'll tell you about a cool thing I was studying this week. Just in close, I had already studied the ancient Jewish wedding because I think it's such a cool picture of prophecy. But I did some more study on it this week just to see if there was anything new about it. You know, in the ancient Jewish wedding, it kind of goes like this. Basically, the groom will, during this whole betrothal period, where he's engaged, if you will, a version of it, to this girl, he will go away and he will build extra rooms onto his father's house. Isn't that cool? Just like Jesus said in John 14, now I go away to prepare a place for you. In my father's house are many rooms. And so the groom goes away. When does he come back to get his bride? Well, actually, the groom doesn't know. And neither does the bride, and neither does the father of the bride. The only one who knows is the father of the groom. And the father, when he says, oh, all the rooms are ready, he says, go get your bride. And it's really cool because there's this big, like, party-like atmosphere. The groom will go to the house. The only thing that the betrothed girl has to do is always be ready. Remember when Jesus talked about the parable of the virgins and their lamps? They weren't ready, and so they missed it. And he comes at night in the ancient Jewish wedding. There's a surprise thief-like element. He comes, and the first thing he does is he shouts out. Isn't that interesting? We saw that last week. There's a shout, there's a trump. The voice of the archangel. He shouts out, and then you know what he does? And I've never known this before until this week. Very cool. The bride's there waiting. She's watching. She's ready. The shout comes, and then he will carry her away on something that's called an aperion. And it's really interesting because they liken it to like a parallel picture of the ark in the Old Testament. It would have two poles through it. You've seen these in weddings, foreign weddings. Four people carry it. She sits on the ark. They lift her up. Isn't that interesting? They lift her up and they quickly carry her away. And she is carried away and she arrives. She's brought under this canopy, which is called a chuppa. And under the chuppa is where the ceremony begins. The chuppa is the same word in Hebrew as the cloud covering that God used over Mount Sinai. Isn't that amazing? It speaks of protection, God's protection. So in where you had the law, Mount Sinai, where it was given, and then you had the ark where they kept the law, then they would carry it up and away. And as they carried it up and away, God's covering was over them. And it's interesting, he will take her back to his house, and for 7 days, they will feast on all this food that he has stockpiled so that they can feast and consummate the wedding. For 7 days, they're locked in, just the bride and the groom. And then they come out, and it's a celebration. Not exciting? So, those of you getting married this year, you're doing it wrong. Don't do one. Do a 7-day party. Okay, I'm just kidding. It is so exciting to talk about Jesus and his return for his church. But it is far more exciting for me to know that each and every one of you in here, your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. The heart of Jesus to go to the cross is a heart that is two things. One, first and foremost, pure, absolute obedience to his Father in heaven. But second, it's you. say, what do you mean it's me? The Bible says, who for the joy set before him, Jesus suffered the cross. What was the joy? It was knowing that many sons and many daughters would come to salvation because he could pay for their sin with his own blood. So I wonder if you'd just stand in this place with me for a moment before we close in worship. So before we do that, I want to give you opportunity to respond to his call of love that was confirmed on Calvary's tree for you. I just wonder if you'd just close your eyes and bow your head. If you're in this place today, you say, I do not know that I am spared from the wrath that is to come. I do not know that my sins are forgiven. I do not have that clean cleansing inside of my life. I've just been doing my own thing, but I want my sins forgiven. Look, with every eye closed, with every head bowed, I want to challenge you in a second, not right now, but just in a minute, to just raise your hand and I'll lead you in a prayer that you can pray wherever you're standing, or wherever you're watching or listening or driving in the car, wherever the case may be. The call of salvation is to you today. Is to be part of the bride. And to be part of the bride, you have to be separated from the ways of the world and the sin in your life. You have to be divorced from the world to marry Jesus. And that's an acknowledgement that not just the fear of I don't want to pay for my sin, but an acknowledgement that your sin is your sin and that it hurt Jesus. And that he bled for you, and that he loves you, that he made a way, and that the reason that you're hearing this right now is because he's calling you to himself. Oh, we might get the details wrong, or all of us will be surprised, I'm sure, on the details. But the main point, the main detail that you cannot, absolutely cannot miss, as God sent his son, Jesus, to pay for your sin once and for all, to buy you back, to redeem you with his own blood, with his own sacrifice, that you may know forgiveness once and for all. And that when he comes for you, whether by way of the grave or by way of the air, you'll hear his voice. You'll hear his trump. You'll hear his shout because you're part of the bride, part of the church that is waiting and watching. If you need your sins forgiven today, I want to do this. I want to give you opportunity right now. There's two groups in here, just with every eye closed, every head bowed. First, if there's anyone in here and you've been away from the Lord and you need to return to the Lord and return to his forgiveness and his grace and to wake up and stop running away and escaping. If that's you, just want you to raise your hand where you are. I want to pray for you first. If that's anyone here, just been drifting from the Lord, just been running away, awesome. Anybody else? So I've been doing my own thing. I just want to come home to the Lord. Praise the Lord. Anybody else? Just lift your hand. I want to pray for you. If that's you. Okay, awesome. Put your hands down. And then is there anyone in here today that says, I need to know Jesus. I need to be forgiven. I need to have my sins forgiven. I believe what Jesus did on the cross was for me. I believe he died, he was buried, he rose again to pay for my sin, and I want to receive that in faith. If that's you, just raise your hand wherever you are here. Say you want to know the forgiveness of Jesus. Just lift your hand wherever you're standing. I want to pray for you. And say, I'm done with living for my sin and living for myself. I want the forgiveness, the grace of God. If that's you, just raise your hand. I want to pray for you. Okay, all of you, let's pray. Close your eyes, let's pray. Father, we thank you today for Jesus. We thank you for our soon coming King. Lord, for those that know you, but have wandered from you, Father, would you just pour out your grace upon them right now? just as you did with the prodigal son. Lord, may they feel that embrace from the Father, that love that they've come home. And Lord, that they would pray something like this: Dear God, forgive me. I've been away, and I choose to return to you right now. And Lord, for those in here that don't know you, whether they lifted their hand or whether they didn't, or they're watching or listening, Lord, right now I pray that they would pray something like this in their heart: Dear God, forgive me. I'm a sinner. Thank you for sending Jesus. Jesus, thank you for dying for my sin. I place my faith in you, my hope in your salvation. Thank you that you conquered my sin with your death upon the cross and your resurrection. You offered me new life. Forgive me, cleanse me, come into my life. Be my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's